Welcome to the Changemaker Sessions, my lovely beings. Tonight, our topic is focusing and activating your year's goals. So I so appreciate the spectacular souls that are here. And I welcome the sweethearts that are joining us and watching the replay. Good to have you here too. I am Kimberly Carroll. I am a coach for Changemakers. So what that means is I help people who want to make a bigger difference in the world with the deeper inner work, with building some really high performing habits, and also creating the strategies that will make you unstoppable. That's my goal for each and every one of you, to make you unstoppable. Tonight, I want to help you get focused on what specifically and deliberately you want to create this year as a change maker. I also want to help you start to create your strategy around that and also build some momentum to make sure that strategy doesn't die on you in the first 2 weeks. So we're going to fit a lot into the next 70, I guess now 65 minutes. And folks, it is really important that we do this work because we're starting this year off in a fairly volatile and challenging environment, no matter what cause you work in, particularly most of you are in some form of social justice, some of you are healers, some of you are mission-led leaders, and no matter who you are, this world is throwing lots of curveballs at us. And so we're going to need each and every one of you change makers to get on your game this year. And I'll make a confession. I get really jazzed about New Year. I know it's a man-made calendar and it's like this sort of, okay, artificial January 1st, but I love resets, okay? And the resetting of the calendar is a really powerful time to do your own sort of reset, your own individual reset. And why are resets vital? Well, they're especially vital for change makers, because if you don't do periodic check-ins around where you're coming from, like what you've done and how that's worked out for you, where you want to go and how to do it, you will so easily slip into a cycle of reactive versus creative, okay? Reacting to life as opposed to creating life. And what happens when you're just reacting to life, your days and your weeks are made out of putting out fires, responding to the squeaky wheels, getting wrapped up in busy work, or trying to do it all and getting overwhelmed and freezing, getting paralyzed. And we cannot afford that for you brilliant folks out there. So tonight, I'm going to take you through a process. We're going to use a formula to identify and focus these goals. I'm sure many of you already have some goals or at least some area that you're focusing on, but we really want to see if we can focus those in as much as possible. We're going to do some brainstorming around action steps for those goals. We're going to get some accountability built in around that action plan, and then we're going to help you create the right energy to support those actions, to create that momentum. Sound good? Yes, everybody's here. Okay, I see some more beautiful faces. Janet, Angeline, Patricia, Michelle. Yeah, so good to see you all here, folks. Yay. Okay, so our first step tonight is the focus part. We're going to decide how to focus in our goals, okay? So for some of you, you may have no idea coming in here tonight what direction you're going in the change-making category, okay? So hopefully this will help you generate some ideas. You may have, you know, like obviously causes and issues that are close to your heart, but you don't know what you're bringing to it right now. For so many of you, you know that You know where you're going, but there's so many things you could be doing, and you are so overwhelmed knowing which one to do and in what order, okay? And some of you already know the specific projects you're working on this year. So it's going to be a matter of figuring out the specific parts of that, which will be most effective for you to hone in on, okay? So a lot of you have probably heard about the 80-20 rule. You know, it's just like 20% of what you do will result in 80% of what you produce. Okay. So it's just the idea that when you get really smart about what moves the needle in your mission, you will automatically get incredibly productive. Okay. Just by being able to focus on that. So so what we're going to do to start off with is I'm going to take you through a 5-step formula that is about identifying your passions, your assets, places of impact, ways of working, preferences of working, and energy, the energy that you want to create, the feeling you want to create. And this is to help you focus in on the best ways for you uniquely to contribute at this juncture. Okay. So what we're looking at is, who is Krista? Who is Ken? Who is Rosemary? And what at this juncture is the most impactful thing for them to focus on? Okay. So just a little note though, some of you may be coming in here deciding, having already decided that the goal that you need to focus on this year is more about you than your cause. So for example, maybe you experienced burnout this past year. So your goal may be more about health. Or maybe you've gotten too isolated and your goal is going to be around connection. Or maybe there's been some depression you've been dealing with. So, you know, your goal might be around wellness or joy, the building of joy. So this section may not apply so much to you as the last, you know, the other three sections of tonight's process. But play along, you know, see what comes up for you in case, you know, there's a new passion or a new direction or at least a little something that you can keep your eye on this year as you heal yourself in the ways that you need to heal to be able to get back into your mission. Sound like a deal? Okay. So I just sort of want to get a little bit more, I just want to get a little clearer about what some general issues are versus general goals are versus what some more specific goals are. Okay. So for example, maybe your goal is around educate. You want to see all children in the world get educated around meditation. But maybe your specific goal is going to be figuring out the framework for that or piloting a project at a school where you know a teacher with one class. Okay. For example, maybe your goal is to help, you know, really make the world aware about how much animal agriculture contributes to the climate crisis. Okay. And that's your general issue, but maybe your more specific goal is going to be do a YouTube series about that. Or maybe it's going to be bring in a speaker to your environmental group to speak about that. Maybe you're going to organize an event around that. Maybe you're going to do a series of, you know, try to submit a series of op-eds around it or do letters to the editor whenever there's an environmental story that you're going to comment on. Okay, so those are getting into more specific, manageable, you know, goals that you can really hit the ground running on. You can have it on a schedule. You can figure out the frequency. So I just wanted to sort of give you a little bit more of a sense of what we're talking about when we're taking an issue and we're zoning in. Okay, so our first area that I'm going to get you to do a little bit of writing around is the area of passion. Now, this area is about, okay, what are the issues or the areas or the mediums that you feel most drawn to work on? Okay, so what, you know, what issues, what causes are closest to your heart? What areas areas of communication and getting things out there are your specialty and your favorite, are the things that you're really drawn to? What mediums do you love to work in? Like, do you love to teach? Do you love to create? Do you love to write? You know, things like that. So I've got a list of questions that Kirsten in the corner there is going to be helping moderate tonight for me. I've got a list of questions that she's put into the chat. And these are the questions. You don't need to answer every question, but I want you to go through them all. And I'm going to give you about a couple of minutes to do this section and just to see what comes to the surface. So some of the questions are, what do you care deeply about? Okay. What lights you up? What in this world do you stand for? What are the changes you'd like to see in the world? If you were, you know, king, queen of the world, what would you like to see happen? What are issues that you feel really strongly about? And get as specific as possible about this. What moves you the most about this issue? What types of activism or advocacy interest you? And what revs you up about this particular type of activism or advocacy? All right. So I'm going to give you 2 minutes. Can everybody see the questions in the chat? Everybody got access to the chat? Okay. Excellent. So just go through and see what comes up around that. Okay. 2 minutes. And I'm going to put a little bit of music on while you do these 2 minutes. So this isn't about what's needed. This isn't about what you should do. This is about what do you want to do? What's pulling you? Don't let there be any limits. We're going to move on to the next category. Now, I know that there's a lot there, and this may just be the beginning of your exploration, but I want to move on to number 2 consideration, and that is assets. What do you have to offer? Okay, so I'm just gonna put the music down for a second. So what can you bring to the table? The skills or talents that you have, education or training that you have. It might be some of the qualities that you know, are your best qualities. You know, what do others say they love about you? What about you touches or influences others? What do you like most about yourself? What makes you generally awesome? Do you have any valuable or unique life experiences that you can bring to your mission? Any circumstances that you've experienced, any viewpoints that might be different, any approaches that might be different from geographical to, some sort of social status to, particular, you might be a person of color that has a particular viewpoint. And also, what resources might you have access to? Those are all assets. Generally awesome. Do you have any valuable or unique life experiences that you can bring to your mission? Any circumstances that you've experienced, any viewpoints that might be different, any approaches that might be different from geographical to, some sort of social status to, particular, you might be a person of color that has a particular viewpoint. And also, what resources might you have access to? Those are all assets. So if, Kirsten, if you can put that into the chat, and then we'll let you give yourself a little time to explore that. So once again, what are the assets that you might be able to bring to your mission? And those assets could be anything from comedy, I'm comedic, to I'm incredibly empathetic and such an attentive listener. I'm fiery and I can pretty well persuade anybody to do anything. Whereas the skills, talents are a little bit more straightforward. I'm good at accounting. I have a PhD in global studies. We need so much more diversity in the social justice movement. So any viewpoints that are unique or, somewhat unique, any life experiences you can bring to the table. Resources you have access to, maybe you have a connection to a community that could be really useful and engaging, or maybe you have some extra money you can throw at something to help get it off the ground. Maybe you have a space that could be really great for hosting events. Okay, let's move on to our third one, and that is impact. Are there Are there places of need in your area of interest? You know, real sort of a high need or opportunities that you uniquely might have in this area. So Kirsten, if you want to sort of drop that into the chat, this sort of list, we're talking about, you know, what's your cause missing? Is there a burgeoning area of activism that you would be suited to? Do you have connections that could create a special opportunity for you to make impact? Are there areas or projects where it's not going to be as hard for you to sort of get involved as others? Maybe there are areas or projects in your area of interest that are currently underserved. Or really think about, are there some projects where you could just really make a high impact? Maybe you're in a demographic that's really needed for a particular initiative. Maybe there's a part of your cause that everybody sort of flocks to, but one, a part that's really important but is kind of ignored. Maybe there's a project you really respect that really won't get off the ground unless you bring a particular skill to it. Maybe there's just a project this year that just needs all hands on deck, and you're like, I need to get into this and I need to help push it over. All right, folks, I know that I'm sort of speeding you along. And like I said, we don't need to finish tonight, but we need to at least start the process. So we're going to move on to the fourth thing to consider, and that is ways of working. And this is what people kind of forget about. If you're going to be doing your change making and a project for a long time or a particular type of work, it better work for you, okay? It's not, you can't just be like, oh, I'm going to sacrifice. It's also got to be something that brings something to you that works for you. So this section is all about preferences that you might have around approach, around style, how you like to work. Kirsten, you can drop those questions in the chat. And it's questions like, do you like working solo or do you like collaborating? Are you a behind the scenes person, or do you really enjoy, being up front? Would you like a long, steady project you can sink your teeth into, or short projects better for you? Like you just need variety. Do you hope to get paid for what you do, or are you just volunteering your time? Do you like working remotely or in person? You know, things like that. Here's a good question. Do you like to be in a fast-paced kind of think on your feet environment, or are you more of like, okay, just calm, methodical, leave me alone, and I will do my work, okay? The ways of working. And again, you might not have an answer to all of these, but at least get the ones on that just like kind of jump out at you. Yes, I want to support, I don't want to lead. Or I want to work in a large network of people, not just this like same three people. Okay, and one more category, and that is energy. What are the feelings you want to cultivate by doing this? Again, this can't just all be about like service, service, sacrifice, sacrifice. If you want to be able to be in this for the long haul, if you want to stay activated and passionate and engaged, it has to create a specific energy around you. So we'll have you, I think Kirsten dropped those in already. Yeah. So, you know, what do you want to feel in this work that you're doing? But also, how do you want to show up in the world? What do you want to help create as far as the feeling? What do you want to inspire as far as energy goes? So for this one, I really want you to feel into that. Like, imagine doing some of the projects that you're thinking about or the direction you're thinking about, and feel into what you'd like to feel around that. What's the energy that you'd like to cultivate around that? For example, I want the energy around the work I do to feel vibrant, but I also want it to have a spaciousness to it. I want it to feel, I want it to be fierce, but I also need some space. And I want there to be a lot of love around it. That's one of the number one qualities for me. But for some of you, it's going to be about, I want the energy that I feel. I want to feel empowered. You know, I want to feel ignited. Or I really want to feel peaceful around this. I want to feel connected in community. And so as you're looking through these answers now, these five categories that we went through, albeit very quickly, there's probably some particular directions or projects that might be floating to the surface, a few clues, especially if you had some in mind already. If you look at, okay, yeah, so knowing what my passions are and what kind of energy I want to create, knowing how I want to work, and basing that and based on, you know, what I particularly can bring to a project and, you know, where the highest impact is for me and what I have going on, what's coming to the surface. And I'd love to hear in the chat, you know, if there are some ideas that are coming clear, like if there are some things that are kind of becoming apparent for you, please share it in the chat. I would love to hear if this is helping you bring any things up or define any things for you. Okay, so wrapping up on this list, did anything show up for somebody that you were like, whoa, I had never even considered this as part of how to focus in? Like, I never even considered this. Put your hand up if that's the case for you, either your real hand or your digital hand, because I'd just love to hear just real quick a couple of things that might have come up for folks. So anything come up, and remember the sharing, you sharing with others really helps open up other people's ideas and flow. Yes, Anita, you can unmute yourself. What came up for you that was like something like you never hadn't really come up for you before? No worries, Anita. We're all here. We're all loving you. Don't you worry.
To me, about what direction animal activism would be for me.
Yeah.
But just going through these in thoughts, because they are specific to who I am as a person, so that it wow, look at life can be, my life can be married with what's going on in activism and with making a difference with you guys, which is really cool. I'm trying to see how that meshes together as opposed to, you know, just off on my own thing without any purpose, because you see that a lot of people are just, you know, spinning plates. Well, where is the foundation and how can you intertwine the two?
Absolutely, Anita, such a good point, because there are already a lot of amazing initiatives going on. So it's not about always figuring out, this is my project. I need to do and create and execute this. It's about going, okay, I have these skills and I've noticed this organization that I really respect and like, is really in need of something like that, you know? So let me go and pitch this to them. And again, especially if you're volunteering, hey, go and pitch. And if you've got some, you know, if you've got the skills to back it up, they're going to be like, hello, thank you very much. Yes, we would like that, please. And even if you're looking for a paid position, if you've got the goods, you can pitch somebody around that. So it's really important to understand that you don't need to reinvent the wheel. You can find what's out there that you resonate with and figure out what's your role. How do you fit in? What can you bring? The flip side of that is some people are really trying to work on figuring out how to fit into other people's projects. And maybe it's just not the right fit for you. Maybe you're more of a lone wolf, you know, in your mission. And what you need to be doing is figuring out pieces of projects, pieces of your issue or campaign that you could do independently, maybe a research project that you could then offer to the wider movement or an organization. Maybe it is creating your own content, things like that. So it doesn't have to be this big, huge project that's multi-eared. It can be just something that is just really something that you're good at and that you can, you know, contribute in your little piece. And so, I just really want to hit that home, that you need to sort of not think that you have to do it a certain way. A lot of activists in general think that the only way to be an activist is to hold a sign. And that is one of the worst things we have going for change making is that, I mean, again, holding signs, protests, all incredibly impactful things in social justice. However, so is writing, so is creating events, so is, you know, doing things in your own businesses. And so, yeah, so there are so many different ways of being a change maker. Okay. There's all sorts of ways that we probably haven't even discovered yet. Okay. So let me see here. I see that Connie, you can just unmute yourself.
Thank you. And thanks for thank you to Kirsten for trying to direct me there. I still
no problem. We're slow enough that you can just raise your hand and I can
okay.
see you.
Yeah, there we go. So yeah, it helped me a little bit because I've got a lot of stuff swimming around and mm-hmm. and not a good focus. But as I kind of look at it, the strengths and the things I'm comfortable with, one of the ideas was to work locally on the broader issues. So bring it to like yes. I work in a smaller more traditional agricultural community. Mm. So why not bring the issues with wildlife? Like we do experience local issues with local people who are killing coyotes and so on. And it feels like it's taboo, but maybe it's time to start working with council and so on. So
yes.
I like to be investigative and I like to base it on facts and I like to dig up the facts. But I do like to check in on a more upfront basis periodically, work with other people periodically, although I'm better on my own for the most part. So that sort of suits doing a bunch of research and maybe taking a project to council and presenting it and maybe with, you know, a small group of other people. Like it's helped me see that could be very much what would be an effective way for me to work.
Mm, I love it. And, you know, some people, you know, Connie, feel like, okay, I have to take on everything all the time. And this is, you know, too small of a sliver of it. But honestly, if we all take a small sliver, it creates the whole pie. Okay. But what's happening instead is we're all, let me use the pie. I'll keep going with the pie analogy. We're all just all over the place. So we've all got our faces in the pie going, and nothing is getting done. Okay. The pie is getting destroyed. So this is an important, like an important thing that I need to hit home is that you do not have to save the whole damn world, folks. You just have to save your little corner of it. Okay. And to remember that, because it really helps me when I'm like, oh my God, I've got all of this on my shoulders, to realize there are millions of others out there that are trying to do good. Okay. I mean, there's probably many more, but that are actively change makers. And there's still woefully too few for the plethora of problems we have, but it reminds me that it's not on my shoulders alone. And it allows me to get hyper-focused. And that is what we kind of need, a lot of people getting pretty hyper-focused in these various issues. We also need to remember we are planning for a year right now. A year is not a long time, folks. I don't know about you, but I just, you know, did my sort of game plan for the year. And I look back and a couple of those things were on my game plan 3 years ago. You know, like I bit off way too much for a year, way too much. Okay. And what that did is it ended up just making me feel badly, like I was falling short. How about we just take on less and we just really make sure we take it to completion? So Connie, I love that idea. I love, you know, focusing in. And Connie, you are somebody who is multi-talented. You are a great researcher. You can get on the ground and do stuff. And you're really good at communicating in a very professional way to the powers that be. So that is, if you can bring those all together in one project, it's going to be amazing.
Thank you. Thank you for the kind words.
You're very welcome. Okay. So, let me give you a few more ideas about how taking these sort of different these different categories can work. So let me just give you a little example of my kind of journey around specificity. You know, I work in different areas of social justice. You know, environmental indigenous rights, but animal rights is one of my biggies. And so for me, I, you know, when I sort of did this focusing job, I went, okay, well, first of all, farmed animals are the ones that are the biggest amount of being suffering and the least amount of resources going towards. So that was a no-brainer for me. And then I needed to, you know, figure out where I was going to put my energy as far as that went. Well, I started working with Animal Justice many years ago, an organization that was like, oh, so much potential. There's nothing like it here in this country, but they need people power. Okay. And that was the need. I saw the need, and I also saw the potential for impact. And then there were so many things to be done, but I chose my places to focus based on my assets. You know, I have campaigns experience, so I focused there. I have a background in television, so I focused a lot on voicing and hosting within the organization and the movement. You know, I have a talent for diplomacy and strategizing, so I brought those things to the table, and also my producing skills to help create undercover videos. Now, that's a lot, but considering all of the things that I could be doing, that is still very much getting specific. And everything outside of that, I say no to. I just say no to. It's not where my talent lies. It's not where I'm going to make the best impact. It's not where the use of my energy and time, is going to be best spent. So I just say no. It allows me, because I'm clear about where I should be spending my energy, it allows me to say no to the things that aren't my forte. Okay. So this could end up being as specific as my goal for the year is to speak at city councils across the country to encourage them to adopt the anti-racism training program that the group that I'm related to has developed for city workers. Okay. It could be staging weekly sit-ins at a polluting corporation with the intention of getting media attention. If you basically have these vigils and create this pressure campaign using these weekly sit-ins. It could be, I'm going to create a YouTube series about electoral reform. Maybe, you know, all aspects of electoral reform and why it's so important and how it's working in different countries. It could be running a vegan lunch series at your company with speakers coming in around different aspects of veganism or animal issues. It could be doing social media for a group or a campaign that you really respect, like if social media is a great skill of yours, or doing accounting for that group, or doing tech support for that group, or doing research for that group, or doing investing for that group, okay? So it can be a matter of like, who is doing something I love, and do I have something that they don't have right now, or something that they could probably use more of? It could be writing a chapter. This year, my goal is to write a chapter in this book around basic income. It could be this year, my goal is to create this government petition and to create a team of volunteers to circulate it. Okay. So again, it could be a really big job that has a lot of little subtasks to it, or it could be something very simple, depending also on your time. Okay. And that is part of the way you work. If you've got a regular job that you're spending 50 hours at a week, you're going to have to find something that works within the crevices of your life. Okay. So thank you so much for some of the examples of things. Was there anybody else that wanted to ask a question about what came up for them? Okay, great. We will move on. All right, we're moving up. Now, that was a big piece. That first piece was a very big one, and it was time consuming, but these other pieces are important, but we're going to move through them a little bit faster. So the second part of this process is the game plan. Okay, the strategy. The way a goal becomes a reality, of course, is through action, and specifically through strategic action. So having a game plan not only makes it more likely that you're going to follow through, but it will help you to do things more skillfully. Okay, I don't want you to be wasting any more time. I don't want you to be futzing and clumsing around. I want you to be able to do things more skillfully. So the thing about a game plan or strategy is, the more you can break it down to smaller pieces, the better. Okay, folks, tell me if you agree. Who here just feels overwhelmed a lot in your mission? How many people feel, yeah, okay. It's a huge thing for change makers. It's maybe one of the number one, but it's in the top five of challenges to change makers. It's what gets people, a lot of people getting stuck from going forward in their advocacy and initiatives, knowing what to do in what order and when. So I want you to really listen to this. Overwhelm is just code for you haven't broken it down enough. Okay. If you feel overwhelmed, it means you haven't broken it into small enough steps. Okay. So if you're looking at a part of a project and it's feeling very overwhelming, okay. So what then, this piece, how do I break it down? What are the smaller pieces? What are the next steps to do? And then if you look at that first step and you're like, oh my God, that's still too overwhelming, break that step down. Okay. Break it down until it's manageable. And then you take the first step, and that's what creates momentum to go towards the harder steps and the bigger steps. But you need to be able to get it down to something that is manageable enough for you to start. So a detailed game plan keeps overwhelm at bay, but it also keeps you on track and not so easily distracted, you know, like squirrel, shot ball, you know, things like that. It's what you need to be able to keep you in line. Cause I'm sure many of us are very multi-passionate people. And plus in this day and age, we are just all so distractible. So a game plan keeps you on track. So I want you to pick one of the goals that you just maybe were playing with, that maybe sort of rose to the surface, even if you're not sure for sure if that's the one or that's one of them. Many of us are going to have a few goals this year. I recommend not having more than three big goals in your year. And that includes personal goals. So so my goals for this year are to really get most of my book done. I'm writing a book about change makers. It's also to grow my audience, and it is also to really create a little bit more spaciousness, gentleness in my life, a little bit more peace in my life. So I've got that one personal and those two bigger professional goals. You can have other ones, but those are the ones I want to keep really focused on. So for now, I want you to pick one goal. Okay. Just one that we're going to try this little process on. And what we're going to do is I'm going to give you about 3-4 minutes to start writing down, brainstorming ideas on how to make it happen. Okay. So right now you don't need to do it in any order. You don't need to do biggest to smallest, nothing, just brainstorm. What are some things that will help to make this happen? Okay. How are you going to carve out time for it? What are things you need to get rid of or move aside? What are the resources you'll need for this? Is there skills or training? Do you need to get other people on board? Things like that. I'm going to give you some cues as you go, but I want you to just start brainstorming, what are some action steps around this? All right. So on your mark, get set and go. Brainstorming on this one goal to start with. What are some of the resources you'll need, or equipment or research you'll need to do? Help you'll need to enlist. Is there anybody out there doing something similar that you could pick their brain or read about or collaborate with? Are there any sort of skills or knowledge you need to build around this goal? And how might you do that? Are there YouTube videos, maybe some more formal training opportunities, maybe having coffee with somebody who can give you the lowdown? Whenever, if you're sort of at a blank here, whenever there's a blank, focus on who you could go to for help and make that part of the action steps where you can go to generate ideas. Are there any habits that you might need to put into place to make this goal a reality? Like maybe you're going to have to set aside 20 minutes a day or Saturdays to do this or something along those lines. Maybe you're going to have to make, 10 calls every week around it. Are there dates or deadlines that you could put into place that would be really helpful? And who are these deadlines to? Are there, this is one a lot of people don't think about when goal planning, but is there a quality you need to embody to help make this happen? And how does that fit into your strategy? Like maybe you need to do a little meditation each day if you're doing a lot of outreach work, or you're helping, you're dealing with people in marginalized communities on a regular basis. Maybe you need to create a wellness routine. Okay, so I'm just going to give you about 30 more seconds to just finish up some of that brainstorming. And if you've, you know, already gotten all your ideas down, you know, take those, some of those bigger pieces and see if you can break those down. Let's get into the habit of breaking it down. Okay, so gang, this is the deal. You've got some strategy, you've got some ideas, you've got some action steps down on that piece of paper. Now you need to get that organized. And so we don't have time within this workshop to do that. But what I'd like for you to do right now is I'd like for you to decide on how you're going to, I'd like you to make an appointment with yourself for the next few days, by the end of the weekend, let's just say, where you will sit down with these goal, with these action steps, and you will put them into some sort of manageable order. And so no plan fits all for scheduling, for formatting, for coming up with the overall sort of way that, you know, your strategy plan. But for some, okay, I'll tell you how I do it. So I usually come up with a year plan with all the actions of what I would, you know, what I plan to do. And then I figure out like what gets put into the different months. Okay. And for some of you, that may be far too much for you to compute. Everybody's brains work differently. Or you don't have enough info to be able to do it at this sort of level yet. But what you can do from the brainstorming list is just to choose some action steps for this next week. Okay. It can just be as simple as that. But if you're going to do it this way, this is the trick. At the end of this week, you know, you'll decide on some actions for this next week that you're going to take. And at the end of next week, you do not leave that week without figuring out the actions for the following week. Okay. Because the hardest part of doing this work of creating these actions is to get your energy up and to figure out what you're going to do next. When you're in momentum and you're doing these things and you just go, okay, so I did this, and this is what I'm going to do next week. And then next week, when you've had a little bit of a break over the weekend or whatever, and come back to it, it's already outlined and you can hit the ground running, and that feels good. So you don't have to figure it all out. Okay. Again, that's what really sort of stops people, is like they feel overwhelmed, like by starting over and over again. So keep this line of continuity. If you're not going to do this big schedule, then keep the line of continuity before you finish your week. Figure out what's going to happen in the next week. Again, for some of you, this will, you know, your goal is really simple. It's going to involve a weekly or a daily a daily action. So maybe you're going to decide, I'm going to do a letter to the editor once a week, or I'm going to teach this class, every 2 weeks, or I am going to put out a social, an original social media graphic once a week. Things like that. So it may be very easy and it may not have tons of different steps, but it is also very important to figure out how to track your plan. Okay. Are you going to just have it in a notebook? Are you going to have it in an Excel sheet? Are you going to put the dates in your iPhone calendar? Are you going to, you know, I just have a Word doc that I use, and I have, different sections. That's all I use. It's nothing fancy. And then I, as those things come up closer, I put them onto my weekly to-do list. Okay. So any questions about that, folks? I don't think I finished. I want you to commit to a 1 hour planning and scheduling session within the next week. And I want you to put it into your calendar now, because if you don't do it, if it doesn't go in the calendar, it doesn't go. So if you got some stuff here and you're like, okay, I'm onto something, do not let it sit on your desk for another year. Look at your phone right now, look at your calendar, and figure out, even if you can't do an hour, and half an hour within this next week that you are going to put on your calendar. Okay. Excellent. And yeah, please, in the chat, can you please tell me when you are committing to coming back to this and putting it in an order so you have an actual game plan? Please, in the chat, I want to see. You can just say Saturday afternoon, I'm going to do it Friday, you know, in the evening. I hope not. I hope you're doing something fun Friday, but you know, that sort of thing. So just put that in the chat so I can see that you've got, we've got some accountability. Okay, good. Sunday morning, 10 a.m. Let's Saturday morning. Love it. Okay. Keep it coming. Yeah. Sunday is the day. Sometimes just writing it down is just ups your accountability so much more. And especially when you have some witnesses. Okay. So the other thing that I just want to talk about really quickly is about staying focused and motivated. So I love doing something that I call my weekly top three and my daily top three. And so knowing sort of what your goals are for the year ahead, I think it's really important every week to revisit those goals, to actually look at it. In fact, this year, I am trying to look at my yearly goals every day. Okay, because it's so easy to get caught up in the rush of life. And again, putting out the fires and whatever. And so I am actually like this year, I don't want to forget what's on my list. I actually want to connect to it every day, because what that does is it really allows you to say no to the things that aren't meaningful. It's really hard to say no to say no. So you need to know what's meaningful so you can let the rest go. All right. So looking at those goals every day really helps. And then getting really specific during your next week, what step are you going to take? And it might just be one, or it might be, you know, just three, it might be three that you decide on. And if you're doing like this full time, you may want to do a top three each day. Okay. The top three means no matter what, this will get done. Even if nothing else, even if everything blows up, these three things are going to get done, or this one thing is going to get done each day. And I really like gamifying my tasks. I like at the end of the week, looking at what I'd set out as my action steps. And I put a percentage, you know, hopefully it's going to be 100, 100, 100. But sometimes it's not. Sometimes, you know, it just doesn't happen. So I like giving partial points because it's important to acknowledge how far you have come. The other thing that I think is so super important, folks, especially, again, if you've got a lot of things on the go, if you've got a career that isn't part of your change making, to put time blocks in your schedule. Okay. Don't think the time is magically going to show up. It's not going to. It never does it? No. And so what you need to do is you need to block out time. Maybe it's the same time each day or the same time each week. Maybe it's like every day, you know, before I get into my other stuff, I'm going to spend 20 minutes on this. Or maybe I'm going to do, you know, every Thursday evening is going to be dedicated to this. Okay. Or maybe it's more like I am dedicating 10 hours a week to this. And each week you're going to figure out where that 10 hours is going to go before you go into the week. All right. It's really important to get deliberate about what you're going to do. I also think it's really important to once a month, if you're not going to do it every week, once a month, like set a reminder on the first of the month to do a review. So go back to those goals, see where you're at, make adjustments, review your game plan, add some action steps if you need to, make rearrangements, okay? And the other piece that I love for motivation is having a goal buddy. Okay. Having someone else in your life, they don't have to be, it doesn't have to be the same goal, but hey, that can be really great. But somebody who is like, you know, is like, I need to make this happen this year. This is really important to me. And somebody that you are going to arrange some sort of check-in with regularly to keep you accountable. Okay. So for example, it could be, every week we're going to, drop each other an email that, says whether we hit our goals and what's up for next week. Or it could be, every day at the end of the day, you're just going to say one sentence about how it went for you. Or it could be getting together once a month for a tea and talking over the goals and where you're at in terms of where you want to be. So a goal buddy can be really amazing. Okay. The final element around keeping yourself fueled with these goals, folks, this is a really important one: connecting to your why. To be an effective and lasting change maker in the face of these Mount Everests that we're facing in all of our different causes, it's so important to regularly connect to the reason you're doing what you're doing. Whether that's to end suffering, whether it's to create a more vibrant world, whether it's to bring more compassion to your community, whether it's to build a more healthy planet. I think the best, more change makers with the most longevity, it comes down to love. It comes down to connecting to what is the love that motivates you to do what you do. Okay, the love for others, the love for nature, the love for connection, the love for justice, the love for equality, the love for closeness. You've got to figure out what is the love, because the love is what's going to get you up off the floor when you feel like you have lost too many battles. The love is going to be the thing that's going to keep you open and effective and connecting and compassionate, even when you're getting a lot of swipes at you. Okay. So the love is really important. And that love, that passion, it gets buried. It gets buried in the opposition. It gets buried in the workload and the repetitiveness of what you're doing, the constant challenges. And so when your love and passion gets buried, your change-making can become a real slog. Okay. Momentum, effectiveness takes a nosedive. So connecting regularly to what is motivating you is so key. So that's what we're going to do here tonight, just to end off in our last few minutes. I'm going to take you through a little visualization to remind you of why you're doing what you're doing, why on a Wednesday evening you're here, but you've been here with me for almost 75 minutes as opposed to just watching Netflix. You need to remember. So what I want to do is I want you to get in a really comfortable place where you can close your eyes, or you can cast your gaze downward, but somewhere where you can just have a little bit of focus. And I'm gonna put on a little bit of music. Okay. All right, so if you haven't already, closing the eyes. And let's take in a nice, beautiful, expansive breath. And letting out a big sigh. I'm really a fan of when we're doing sort of visualizing, planning, brainstorming, to really come into the body. And so let's do some shoulder rolls backwards just to really open up the body, to drop out of the head. We've been doing a lot of strategizing, a lot of thinking, but let's come back into a place of being and of feeling. So big shoulder rolls, slow, really feeling the stretching, feeling creating a little bit more space in the bones. Maybe also feeling like you could let that chest fall open a little bit more. And letting those shoulders relax back and down. And with your eyes just resting down, connecting to that breath. And connecting to that heartbeat. Now it's That's right. You can probably feel your heartbeat right now if you really tune in. And now, I want you to go back in time to when you first started to connect to the idea of wanting to create positive change. What issue was it around? Maybe it's an issue that's different than what you're focused on today, but just really that first spark of, I want to be part of the solution, not the problem. Or I want to help. Or I don't want to see these people, these beings in pain. What experience or who in particular moved you to wake up in this area? It might have been a teacher. It might have been an animal who could also be a teacher. It might have been a classmate. It might have been a speaker or podcast. Or a video. And just that original feeling connecting to that. What did you get most inspired or excited by when you were like, I'm gonna do something about this? Breathe into that. I want you to see yourself in some of the best times so far that you've experienced in your change making, in your helping, or on your mission, or with your project. See yourself when you most felt that sense of fulfillment. Where were you? What were you doing? What was happening? And how did that feel in your body? Breathe into that. Amplify that. The successes you've had, or the connections you've made, or the movement that's happened. Breathe in appreciation for what's been good. Now, I want you to picture you working on one of the goals that you've identified today. I want you to picture yourself in the most sort of expansive way, working on that goal in a way that's actually making some movement, that's actually bringing this goal to fruition. What does that look like? And don't just see it, feel it. And what are those who are experiencing your work feeling? See people on the other side of your work. Maybe your work is to wake people up. Maybe you see and feel those people on the light bulbs and the realizations. Maybe your work is to lessen suffering, to make others feel safe. And feel that. What's that like for them? Breathe deeply into the feeling of how your work touches others or affects things. How does that feel? Breathe into how that feels for you. And now, as you're envisioning yourself, you know, executing this goal and the rhythm of it, I want you to also picture and feel the energy that you want to show up to this goal in, okay? That you want to show up to this work in. Maybe it's in a more relaxed way. Maybe it's in a more bold or fierce way. Maybe there's more playfulness around it or joy. Maybe it's about bringing more presence, you know, to it, like really taking in the people and the moments of it. Maybe the energy you want to bring to it is this wild creativity. Some of you did the Word of the Year workshops with me last week. How does your Word of the Year apply to this goal, to the energy you bring to this goal? And where does this energy, where do you feel it in your body? Really breathe into that. And just sort of feel how this energy informs the way you hold yourself in this work, the expression on your face, the way you are with others. The way you face challenges. The way you keep showing up. Okay, breathing fully into that. All right, you have just created a template for your goal and the year ahead. Let's raise the arms above the head. Big breath in. And letting go with a big exhale and just giving yourself a nice activating little shakeout. Just shaking out the head and the body and coming back to eyes open. I would really love to hear, what energy really showed up for you at the end? What was the energy that you really want to bring to this goal or these goals this year? Put them in the chat. I really get a kick out of energies, especially because that's something a lot of people don't think about when they are working on goals. So I want to see them. I'm not taking no for an answer. Let me know what came up for you. Yeah, Vivian said vibrance. I love it. Kirsten said care. Yes, that's beautiful. Keep them coming, folks. I want to hear what energy, how you want to show up to these goals this year. Any other, and I'd love to hear about any other observations about things that you loved or you saw or you felt. I'm seeing heart penetration, calm, more compassion. Do it now. Yeah, sense of momentum, of like force. I love these. And see how everybody's so different, right? And you're going to be different from year to year. Last year, my energy behind things was wild, like this sort of wild creativity and wild, like no limits. And this year it's tender. Okay. That's what I'm bringing to my goals this year, is a tenderness. So it really can help. Oh, I see joy. Joy is such a good one as well. All right. Well, folks, like I said, we went through a longer process, very fast. And so I really want you to honor yourself and this process by making sure that you show up for yourself to do some, more strategizing around this. Oh, I love expression for drama, big persona of joy. Patricia said, I realize I need to shift my energy towards a calmer, more focused approach. I love that. Yeah, I'd love to hear, what was your biggest takeaway today? What is your biggest takeaway around this? There were a lot of things we talked about, but what really stuck with you about your goals for the year ahead? Please put that in the chat as I give you just a little bit of info before we go. There are a couple of other workshops I'm going to recommend that you check out if you want to look more around how to be, how to keep yourself more accountable and more strategic this year. The top three ways to make your week more deliberate. So what I started to talk about, I do a whole workshop on that, and Kirsten will drop that into the chat. There we go. Another one is 5 ways to make a new habit stick. That could be really helpful for you too. The other thing I want to mention is I have a free mini course, Power Tools for Changemakers. And that is really, a course to help prevent burnout, become a more impactful, joyful, and resilient changemaker. If you haven't already done that, just sign up. You'll get it delivered right away, and you can do it, once a day, or one module a day, or you can just do it, binge watch it. And the last thing is, I've got a couple of other ones. My YouTube channel, if you've missed Changemaker Sessions and you want to check out what's out there, my YouTube channel has everything on it, all the replays. And also I offer a bunch of meditations on my website. If meditation and getting calmer and sort of more focused was one of the things that came up for you tonight, that might be a great little daily practice to do. So I'm going to be adding tons more, but I do at least have probably 20 meditations up there that are range from 5 to 15 minutes. Kirsten put those in there as well. Okay, last thing, if you're not already part of the Changemaker Sessions, if you haven't signed up or somehow you got in here, make sure you sign up for those every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Every second Wednesday at 7 p.m. In 2 weeks, folks, our topic is going to be about anxiety. Okay, I don't know a changemaker who doesn't have anxiety about something or other. And it is something that is a challenge I've had to work with all my life. And so we're going to go through some really tangible tools for you to be able to work with anxiety. Okay, last thing, I want to just go see some of what were the takeaways. They were too big, the goals. Rein them in. Okay, I love that. Pick one or two goals and focus on them. We're all here right now. It's perfect. I realize I make too many goals that are too general. Jenny said, little nibbles versus big chomps when taking on tasks. The need to focus. Yes. Okay. So I really hope that that you're going to continue with this process and get everything laser focused. Thank you for staying with me a little later tonight, folks. This was a big process, and I appreciate your patience. You can take yourself off mute because I want to hear your voices. You can just unmute yourself so everybody's got a voice. Hello, everybody. Hello, change makers. Are we going to make this happen this year? Can I hear a yes? Love it, everyone. Thank you so much for bringing your heart and soul, not just to here tonight, but to the world. I know so many of you, and you are brilliant, powerful beings in this world, doing far more than your share of what you should be doing. But thank you for this. I really love it. And all your comments, I will go back and listen to them or look at them later, so I won't miss anything. Thank you so much for being here. Have a wonderful evening and rest of your week, and hopefully we'll see you in 2 weeks, okay? Bye, everyone.
Bye. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.